All right, last talk in this session, Yohann Dudouit has been in the grammar for a while now, and he's going to talk about libCEED. LibCEED got mentioned several times, so this is, I think, a talk that people have been looking forward to. Yohann, please. Well,
yeah, so thank you, Daniel. So this is a bit of an overview talk of the integration of libCEED in MFEM. So as C is getting to an end and the ECP, so it's a work that involved a lot of people. I've listed a few that were involved in the libCEED development, but it's really a team effort, and everybody in the team contributed in some way to this work. So to start with, of course, the diagram that we often use to get back to the basics. And so the main idea of the C project is to not use sparse matrices to represent our finite element operators, but to use a matrix-free representation. So this matrix-free representation is based on a sequence of operation instead of using a single operator. So we often talk about it as having this T vector, which is the vector of all the degrees of freedom in distributed in parallel. Then we have this L vector composed of the processor local degrees of freedom. So we have the P operator that goes from global to local or parallel to local processor local. Then we have the E vector, which is an element local degrees of freedom. So we have the Gather scatter represented by the G operator. And then B operator, which does interpolation from degrees of freedom to value at quadrature points. And then we apply the physics with the D operator and the geometry. So the only operator that contains really data and stored really substantial amount of data is this D that contains the physics and the geometry. And so before going a bit further into all this, and I like to explain a bit why this is a good idea to go matrix free. So I like to start with a bit of a roofline model of modern hardware. And so here what we see is on the left, we have the behavior of the bandwidth in terms of the arithmetic intensity. And on the right, we have the flops in terms of the arithmetic intensity. So the arithmetic intensity is the number of floating point operation that we do per byte that we move in and out from memory. And so what we can see is that here we have three different architectures, so NVIDIA V100, A100, and MI250X. And so if we, like, really there is two regimes, at least for the roofline of GPU. So on the left here, we have the memory bound regime, and on the right, we have the computation bound regime. So ideally, we really want to stay into this memory bound regime. So we want our arithmetic intensity to stay under control. If the arithmetic intensity gets too high, then we go into this computational bound regime, which may impact significantly the time to compute our solution. So for instance, if we look at the ideal computational time in the memory bound regime, the ideal computation time is determined by the amount of data we have to move in and out of memory and divided by the maximum bandwidth of the hardware. And for as soon as we are in the computation bound regime, now, like, it's the number of flops that we have to do for our operator divided by the maximum number of flops. So if we compare those three architectures, what's interesting, for instance, when we compare the A100, which is a dotted line on top, and the V100, which is this plain line here on the bottom, we see that despite the A100 having a much higher ultimate bandwidth, as soon as we get computation bound, like the performance completely drops, and we almost lose all the benefits of having this much more modern hardware. And we back almost to the same performance as what we have on V100. On the other hand, we see that like this other dotted line in the middle, which is the MI250X from AMD, we see, like, this architecture has a much higher maximum number of flops. And as a result, when we get computation bound, the impact on the is more mild on the performance. However, we ideally always want to stay into the memory bound regime, which is a much simpler
to optimize. Mostly when you are in a memory bound regime, you mostly need to care about the quality of your memory accesses, how you read and write the memory, and this type of concept. So you get in computation bound, it's a very different landscape there. You have to think a lot about the ordering of your instruction kind of things, and the optimization is a quite different topic. Okay, so where is a sparse matrix vector multiplication in all this? So if we look at the sparse matrix vector multiplication, the arithmetic intensity is very low per byte. We have something that is under one, actually. And so we are really completely on the left of this diagram. So the quality of the sparse matrix vector is completely determined by the quality of the memory accesses. Therefore, like if we want to run faster by doing matrix tree, like the only solution is to move less data and to potentially like access the memory more efficiently than sparse matrix. Sparse matrix typically have a fairly erratic memory accesses, which are far from being ideal on GPUs. So like now we understand that we have to move less data to run faster. Like what can we expect? So looking closer at each of these operations, if we look at the amount of storage and similarly the amount of data movement, so for a sparse matrix, it scales in O of np to the d, where n is the number of elements, p is a polynomial order, and d is the dimension of the problem. And as soon as we do partial assembly, we go down to O of np to the d. So like what we see is that we potentially move p to the d time less data, which directly means that if everything goes perfectly, we would have a p to the d speed up. So what this means is the potential gain for matrix tree for low order is relatively modest, like we have to look more in terms of constants there, but it can be sometimes interesting in specific cases. But overall, matrix tree is more interesting for high order and for high dimension, as I will show later. So now looking at the critical factor in all this is arithmetic intensity, because in order to have partial assembly be efficient, we have to make sure that we remain into the memory bound regime. And if we look at each one of these operators, the only one that's really critical is the interpolation from degrees of freedom to quadrature point. And so this operator in its native form is an operator that has an algorithmic complexity of O of P to the D. So directly out of the box, this can be a problem, because of course, this can quickly get us into the computation bound regime of the GPU. And really we would lose most benefit, because the cost for applying the operator, a matrix tree operator, at least in this form, is the same for a matrix tree and for a sparse matrix. So if the matrix tree operator is in the computation bound regime, well, we're comparing flops with data movement, because the sparse matrix will remain in the memory bound regime, but the gain is really not that obvious as soon as we get there. So this is why we always talk about those tensor elements and the quads and hexes, and what we always refer to as like sum factorization. So sum factorization is really a critical aspect of getting performance for this matrix-free approach. So the idea is a fairly simple algebraic trick where we just reorder the computations. And so here, for instance, if we look at what's happening when we interpolate the values of degrees of freedom to quadrature point, we express here the 3D basis function as a product of 1D basis functions. And if we look at the algorithmic complexity, because there are 6 indices, basically this is a O of P to the 6 operation. And just by reordering this sum, we can now express this as a sequence of tensor contraction. And now the algorithmic complexity goes down to O of P to the D plus 1. So what this means for the applying the B operator is that we go from O of P to the D complexity to O of the P. And this is critical, because O of the P is going to grow only linearly, with a polynomial order, and therefore we're not going to get into the computation bound regime. And for this reason, we really have a hard theoretical limit on how high of an order we can go for a non-tensor element. And I think it's also important to point out that beyond just the arithmetic intensity of non-tensor elements, the B operator itself is also another problem. So if we look at, we have to store the matrix, which is typically of P to the 2D in size, compared to the P square, because we only store the 1D operator when we do the tensor contraction. And the problem with that is that it's going to be very challenging to have an efficient caching of this B operator for the non-tensor element. And so, especially in GPU architecture, where the memory is very limited, and it's always a bit of a headache to know where we put the data, like this P to the 2D is creating a lot of issues to run efficiently tensor non-tensor elements such as simplices and pyramids, for instance. Nonetheless, so let me now introduce the libCEED library. So the idea of the libCEED library is really to have a one-to-one mapping between partial assembly decomposition and code, like basically the data structures. So like in libCEED, we have like this seed operator, seed basis, seed element restriction, seed function, and seed vector, which each one of them correspond to like the seed operator corresponds to the whole matrix free operator. The seed basis is a representation of the B interpolation operator. And then we have the element restriction that goes from global to element local restriction. And then the Q function, which is really the guts of the operator, and which represent the physics really that is represented with the D operator. So in libCEED, this D operator is typically a C function, which is the only thing that the user really has to write. The fact that it's written in C makes it quite portable between different architecture and languages. Since most of the performance critical code is in the B operator, but the users don't have to write any of that code. Like this is like the purpose of the libCEED library is to write those B operators for the users. And among other things, but yeah, like one of the main tasks is writing efficiently this B operator for the user, so that user don't have to write it. And then there is, of course, a seed vector that does a bit of data management between CPU, GPU for the users. The libCEED library we get a bit on the libCEED library. So libCEED has a bunch of different backends. So it's quite a different approach from MFEM, a bit like this is a bit like MFEM has the same code for all architecture, whereas in libCEED, we have a different code and different backends that are targeting different architecture. The advantage of this approach is that we can specialize the code for each type of architecture. So the main backend that are here, like are referred here, and maybe the to highlight, we have like those CUDA heap cycle backends, which are written in native form. There is a different variation of them. The gen version is one of the most efficient for the GPU kernel, and it relies on a just-in-time compilation. And so there is a bit of code generation and a just-in-time compilation in order to fuse kernels together and get as much performance as possible. Some noticeable other backends are the Magma backend, which we will show soon, has a very good performance actually on non-tensor elements, and also the XSMM backend, which has a very good performance on CPU. Like, so if you're a CPU user, this is a very good backend to look at. And then there is some extra features that are coming with the libCEED library. In particular, computing the diagonal of any operator. This can be really convenient for something like Jacobi preconditioners or just getting the diagonal. Small remark, like this is not very fast code on GPU. Like typically, I think MFEM diagonal computation are typically much faster than the libCEED one, but
you don't often compute this too many times, so it's okay. Similarly, the libCEED also provides an interface to assemble sparse matrices. By default, it's a COO format. It's also quite a slow algorithm, but it's here, it works, and so it can be useful. This is not currently integrated in MFEM. I think that Andrew Barker in his pull request integrated it in some way. This could be like a potentially integrated later. There is also last thing, which is a PIM integrated from Jeremy Thompson. This is also not currently integrated in MFEM, but this is provided by libCEED, and this would be fairly easy to integrate if there was interest into using this. So now looking more about the libCEED integration in MFEM. So first, like, how do you use it? So you compile your libCEED library, and then you use the fly MFEM, you see it equal yes when you compile MFEM. And then it's very similar to the way you select your device in MFEM, except that instead of having CPU, CUDA, HIP, here you're going to say seed CPU, seed CUDA, and seed HIP. And hopefully everything should be transparent for the user after that. It should call under the hood the seed backend and do the right thing. One thing that can be interesting is to use the colon symbol to select the backend in the backend. So I get a bit of a recursive aspect to this. For instance, as I said earlier, the Magma backend can be quite efficient on a non-tensor element. And so selecting it like this, this is how you select the Magma backend if you have it. So why would you choose to use the libCEED backend? I think one of the main reasons currently is the support for simplices and mixed meshes, which can be of interest to some users. There is limited support to p-adaptivity. Serial for sure. You have to be careful probably with HP refinement there. I don't know, like from what I understand. And then we also have a nice interface, I think, to construct partial assembly. And you also have like fully matrix free operator. So the difference here with this fully matrix free is we don't store anything. We compute absolutely everything on the fly. And also, there is this work by Andrew Barker, where did some algebraic multigrid based on the libCEED interface, which can be used, I don't know how successfully, but I have not tried it myself too much, but this is definitely something to look at. But on the downside, like MFEM, the native MFEM, definitely supports a lot more integrators than libCEED currently does, and in particular, there's a HDHCurl integrators that are currently supported. I hear that Sebastian has done some work in that direction using the libCEED feature. And also an important thing to note is that the GPU backends are typically non-deterministic. So there is deterministic option, but so if this is important for you, like we use atomic operation for performance purposes, this may result in slightly non-deterministic behavior. So currently the supported integrators are the following. So we have like classic mass convection, advection, diffusion. You can also make a nonlinear operator with matrix free, which can be quite interesting. That's about it. And so now to look at the performance. First, like I like to show like what is the kind of behavior when we compare a sparse matrix vector product using cuSparse here to a matrix free. When we look at on the log scale, what we see is that basically we get when we do matrix free, we get from the log scale perspective the same performance for any polynomial order pretty much, unless the first order is below everything. But really, like what's happening is that the sparse matrix really get very expensive as we increase the order, and whereas like matrix free approach keeps a fairly constant cost. So let me say a few more words on this performance plot. So this is a throughput in our vertical axis and degrees of freedom horizontal axis. So what we see on both the sparse matrix and the matrix free approach is that we have this red line highlighted on the right diagram here, a plot. And this is really a constant cost. So in some way, there is absolutely no benefit in doing a problem that's roughly lower than 10 to the 5 in number of degrees of freedom. And it's the same for a sparse matrix and for a matrix free approach. And then really the maximum throughput is determined by the amount of data that we move per degrees of freedom. If we look closely at the matrix free approach, we'll see that actually the higher you go in order, the less data you move per degree of freedom. Okay, which is the opposite of what happened for sparse matrix. So a small comparison between like libCEED and native MFEM. So and here the white dots are the libCEED backend, and in green we have the MFEM, native MFEM. So we see like overall we see like slightly improved performance for libCEED. Honestly, it's mostly is due because the libCEED backend is non-deterministic, whereas MFEM does the native MFEM does a deterministic approach, which has some cost to it. But actually, if we were to look closer, I think the MFEM backend maybe a bit faster if it was to do the deterministic non-deterministic approach. So what we have here is BP1 and BP3, which are a scalar mass and a scalar diffusion problem, and on two different architectures. So we have V100 and MI250X. So we have a slightly better performance with libCEED. Now here, what I compare is, so I was mentioning there is those two approaches. I had never really looked closely at what the performance is between like this partial assembly and this fully matrix-free approach, where we compute absolutely everything on the fly. The idea that motivated this is that theoretically, you move less data if you're fully matrix-free, because you don't even move the quadrature data. Yeah. Well, not in all cases, but this is the idea. And you do more computation. So you run into the risk of being computation bound by doing so. So what we see is that actually it doesn't really pay off in these cases to do a fully matrix-free. Except for like those vectorial problems for high order. But overall, like, it doesn't really pay off. It can still be interesting because for partial assembly, you have the setup phase, which if you only use your operator one time, like you may just as well use no assembly at all. Like this, you just, you don't have to manage those quadrature data, and you just reevaluate your operator on the fly.
Also for higher orders, potentially. You
will
run out of.
Oh, yeah. Like you use a bit less memory, also. Yeah, that's true. Something a bit more interesting, a bit more new that I had never looked at before. I think Sebastian had looked a lot more into it than me, actually. So here, what I'm looking at is the performance on simplices and mixed meshes. So, what I have on the left here is a hex mesh. And I put as a reference the best performing backend of libCEED, which is the GPU heap gen. So this is on the MI250X. And then in white I have the GPU heap shared and the GPU heap magma, and this is the deterministic version of the magma backend actually. And so in green. So we see that there is quite a significant discrepancy on the hex elements between the gen and the other backends. But the advantage is the other backends run on simplices and mixed meshes, whereas the gen backend only works on hex tensor elements, unfortunately. However, what we can notice between the shell backend and magma backend, the magma backend is doing very well on simplices. If you compare the performance on tensor and non-tensor elements, actually magma achieves pretty much the same performance on both, which is we could go into detail of why, but this is very good result. And then here on the right, I have a mixed mesh, which is here, of course, I refine it to get more degrees of freedom because we want it to be in the order of 10 millions of degrees of freedom here. And what we see is that with the magma backend, we get decent performance, honestly. We get a gigahertz of, or between half a gigahertz of and a gigahertz of on the mixed mesh, which actually surprised me. I was expecting to get a lot less. But if you use the ship, like the GPU heap shield backend, which was one of the original backend that we wrote, then you get a lot less with the performance. So it's actually quite important to pick correctly the backend here to get the maximum out of this. Currently, you can't really use the heap gen on hexes and the magma depth on simplices, but really there is no, like, this is just because it should be fairly straightforward. If there is interest, I could probably give directions in how to have better heuristic on which backend to use for it, so that you can both use the GPU heap gen with the magma deterministic backend to and combine those two and hopefully get higher performance on mixed meshes. But this is not currently supported, but it's good work. Maybe now, yeah, I should probably conclude. I don't know where I am on time, but
you should conclude.
Yeah, so this is my conclusion. So reason to use that, the libCEED backend, you have competitive performance. Oh yeah, also something I didn't mention, you get like good performance on the broad range of operators. You run on any hardware, like you can already run in cycle. You can even run on cycle in MFEM if you want to, using the CPU, seed CPU with the cycle backend. I don't recommend it though, because it will generate a lot of data movement between CPU and GPU, and it will probably not result in very good performance. And as we saw, we have simplices and mixed meshes support. I also didn't show any performance result on p-adaptivity, but this is supported to a certain extent. And future direction, I think like HDVHQL, which is now supported in for non-tensor element in libCEED. But I think this work has mostly been done already by Sebastian. We could also do a discontinuous Gedanken support using a similar approach as what is currently in MFEM. But this will need to be done. And finally, adding to the platform. Yeah, thank you for this. And if you have any question, I'm happy to answer them.
Okay, thank you, Yohann. I know we're behind. Don't worry, we'll still get a break. There are a few questions. One is from Dennis on Slack. He asked on slide 10, what was the operator and what was the GPU?
Oh, this is fairly long result. I think this is B100, and this is for BP3, if I remember correctly. So this is a scalar diffusion problem on B100. It's either scalar mass or scalar diffusion. I think it's diffusion,
kind of difficult to say. I think it's like 2 gigadots there. So
yeah, I think due to the performance, I think diffusion.
That would be my guess too. All right, and Joe on the Zoom chat. Okay, let's see. There are two questions. Joe, do you want to unmute and ask them?
Sure. Let me see what I. When you're computing the DOF per second, is that per CG iteration or is that for the entire?
That's per CG iteration. Yeah. Okay. Sorry, I may have missed that. Yeah, it's per CG iteration. Yeah. So, but like, we normalize everything so that you can compare like different polynomial orders and so that the number of iteration doesn't matter between different polynomial orders. It's
Great. And then when you compile for multiple architectures, like with MFEM, I'm able to pass in the flags to target like SM60, 70, and 80 so that we can experiment on different, from our laptops and up to our clusters. Is that in the documentation on how to do that with the libCEED backend?
I mean, the libCEED backend depends which one, but this is done on the fly, I think, what you're...
Yes, you do it on the fly.
I just read what is the architecture on the fly and I compile it just in time for your architecture.
And that only happens the first time you load the kernel then, right?
If I remember correctly, I think it happens the first time you apply the kernel.
Right.
The way it's done in libCEED.
Yes.
I thought you had a question about hybrid, like running on CPU and GPU. Okay, yeah, so.
Thank you.
Okay.
Right, maybe another quick question.
So I put the point of doing GPU computer set, you have massive flops per second. But if you're constantly running in the memory bound regime, then what is the point of having a GPU?
The point of having a GPU?
Don't you want to be in the computation bound regime? I mean, that means that you're using the GPU to its max potential, right?
If using the GPU is your goal, sure. But usually the criteria is more like how fast you get to your solution.
That's exactly.
And so, if you want to get your solution fast, you want to be in the memory bound regime.
So, GPUs are not just great for floating point computation. They have amazing memory bandwidth. That's what's winning here.
Basically, you typically have like a 10x faster bandwidth usually compared to CPUs. Like when you see on a supercomputer, it's about 10x ish. Depending on what kind of application you can expect, any or you see often more, sometimes less.
I have a question about the GPU. You said it's non-deterministic. What exactly do you mean by that? Do you use a random selection or what?
It means I use an atomic operation for adding when you do the assembly of the element contribution into a global contribution, we use atomics to do that. And so this operation is non-deterministic, so you can add like a floating point different things it's just like the order in which those values are being added can result in very small differences, which depending on the type of application may be a problem or not.
It's round off error due to summation, so something doing the sums in different order basically. The summation.
Okay. Now that depends on the whatever the atomic operation is in mass probability, right? Characteristics, whether it's associative or not, your result potentially will diverge or converge.
Yeah.
I mean,
the operation is mathematically associative, but commutative. But in floating point numbers, it's not.
Depends. But then, how do you guarantee that with this kind of a non-deterministic, you always can get a converged solution?
Well, all of them are correct answers. Like in some way, you have a single solution in real numbers, but you have an infinite number of solutions. Not infinite, but you have multiple solutions on floating point numbers.
So it's always floating point difference. So unless your algorithm is super sensitive,
okay,
floating point differences, you should get essentially the same answer.
Yeah, I think, like if you have turbulences, maybe with like things that are very sensitive to numerical differences, it may result in different simulations. But if you do, I don't know, maybe wave propagation, okay, things like that, you will not see anything probably.
So what you're saying is the convergence path may not be the same, but you will converge to the same endpoint.
It's just like, you're not going to, okay. I doubt that you will end up with instabilities from a numerical, I really don't think so. It shouldn't change any property of your algorithm.
Whatever the solution you get is within your target solution set, right? It will not go out of the, get a totally different solution set.
No, it's not going to do that. I mean, unless you have something very turbulent and it can...
Correct.
I would agree.
But it's not the exact same solution. So if you want to reproduce things, if you want to test and compare exact numbers, it will vary from run to run.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So for CI, this was a problem for us where we look at the differences, and this would show in our CI, for instance.